Talking fishing, talking fishing, nothing but fishing, talking fishing. If it's facts about fishing that you want to know, then tune in, folks, because this is the show. We'll show you all the right bait to use, so sit right back, you got nothing to lose. Doesn't really matter if it's trout or carp, flathead, marlin, or a gummy shark. Listen to the guys and you can't go wrong. They'll be talking about fishing till the cows come home. Talking fishing, talking fishing, nothing but fishing, we're talking fishing.
And welcome everyone to Talking Fishing, a massive episode tonight. We're going to talk about lots of things, including water, but what a magnificent run of weather we've had over Easter. 30 degrees last Saturday when I saw the mighty Saints win at the MCG, but a lot of people were out fishing as well, and adds what beautiful weather we had for Easter.
Oh, we couldn't have got any better weather for Easter. Calm conditions, 30 degrees, no one would have picked that at this time of the year, but it reflected in how many people were away. And Dave, I know you have been down at a caravan park in the peninsula, and it was chock-a-block.
Absolutely fantastic. Yeah. Trelly, normally when it's 30 in Melbourne, is it 40 in Shepparton?
Yeah, pretty right, but no, about 30 degrees up where
yeah,
we were.
It stays the same this sort of time of year, but great.
Yep.
Like, I mean, we couldn't show all the catches of the week this week,
but no,
some unbelievable Murray cod catches up your way.
But it's been fishing really, really well. It always does up to Easter, but we had an immigration. An immigration or from Melbourne people?
Melbourneites?
They come over the Great Divide in just droves up to the Goulburn and the Murray, but they all enjoy themselves.
Do you guys let the people from Geelong in?
The Mexicans?
Oh.
A couple of them.
Because talking about people from Geelong, we are delighted to have no stranger to talking fishing, but the Minister for Water, Lisa Neville. Welcome, Lisa.
Great to be here this evening. I'm a bit worried. I love Shepparton.
I
love the North of the Divide, but we can love Geelong as well.
In terms of fishing,
really, we're out there. We're doing well.
So diverse.
I'll pay that.
It's so good.
Yeah.
And I'm not a fisher, but I love eating it. And there's such great fishing out there at the moment.
And there's so good fishing. Lisa, I don't know, the people from Geelong, people from Shepparton, if they don't have a T-shirt or a stubby holder, because Kevin is yelling in my ear to say, promo the T-shirts, because he wants to sell T-shirts and stubby. So there you go. Go to talkingfishing.com.au.
Can I say, in mine is water. Just say, just in there is some water. Melbourne water. The stubby holder's great, but it is only got water.
We've got the water bottle for you.
Exactly.
For water drinks water, don't worry about it. Now, I'm going to talk to you about a few water storages tonight and the desal plant, the north-south pipeline. We're going to talk about everything.
Some easy issues tonight.
But before we do that, folks, let's have a look at what's been caught by the people at home. It's time for Catch of the Week.
Catch of the Week, brought to you by Shimano.
What a great time for the young kids to get out.
Yeah,
and
excellent.
Charlie, we've got a busy show tonight.
Yes.
Next week, we are going to show your grandson.
We're not showing
it tonight, but...
How old is he?
Three.
Oh.
Loves his fishing.
Oh.
Amazing footage of your grandson will be on the show next week. But let's kick it off with Blake Robinson, a lovely 60-centimetre flathead off Summers. So good to see the kids catching the flathead. And, you know, to be brought up on bread and butter species like a flathead, which are one of the best eating. How good is that?
Right.
And you know it's a good flathead when you got to hold it like a barrel tuna.
Well, another fish that's up there with the barrel tuna is the old Mako shark. And they're out there, folks, so get out there and enjoy them, because they'll only be around for probably another month before it gets a bit quiet and cold. But Jack Kloster got a lovely estimated 90 kilo off Kilcunda.
That's a big Mako.
Great. So how are you cooking that? Just tell me, how do you cook that?
Yeah, that plate's not big enough, is it?
Mako shark's one of the best eating sharks in the sea.
Yeah, okay.
And it's your flake that you get at the fish and chip shops on a premium scale, I think. So just a bit of batter. But every bit of that shark is edible. It's just absolutely fantastic.
I hope he was dead.
Well, quite often, three hours later, they have a snap at
us. Just a reminder that's
so I reckon he was dead. Another young one out on the water was Natalie Ray. Have a look at this. I think it was either a father or a grandfather. A lovely flathead off Carrum.
floodies are getting bigger.
Yeah, they are.
They're everywhere.
Now, just to prove how good the fishing is, guys. I'm not going to say that anyone can catch a fish, right? But when you take out the Minister for Fishing and you have a cracking day on Good Friday, have a look. Jala Pulford is the next catch of the week. Some lovely cuttlefish and calamari were
caught
off.
That's a big catch he's got on there.
Who caught the cuttlefish?
Jala.
I heard Jala might have had a little accident with
the first one. I had the accident.
Yeah. Oh, you had Jala tried actually to caught, catch the first one.
Jala caught the first cuttlefish on board and I dropped it because I didn't get the net. Jala's son Hamish caught the second cuttlefish, which was the biggest for the day. And he wouldn't hold it, so Jala did.
Okay.
Don't worry, Jala. David does it to people all the time.
But no, fantastic fishing off Portsea on the weekend. And unfortunately, the King George White, we did that in the afternoon, and they didn't play ball because of the full moon, I'm blaming. So.
Oh, really? Yeah. It's a pink moon, too.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
Pink, which was amazing.
Werribee South is another place that's featured the last few weeks, boys, and been absolutely fantastic. Jack Collegia got a beautiful calamari. His brother sent this photo in. Go, Jack.
That is great. Great
squid.
Beautiful photo.
Some big calamari rings off that bad boy.
Oh, yeah.
Lou Cipri. He got some beautiful calamari, headed out to Mud Island on the weekend, boys.
Yep, there's another one.
I would suspect either the Simmons or the Pinner's Channel there, because he said he got a few whiting as well, Lou.
Nice.
But pretty good. Point Cook, Georgia and Sienna. Have a look at this for cuteness, right? They're twins.
Yeah, right.
And they got a 1 metre gummy shark off Point Cook. How good is that?
Look at that.
To see the kids out fishing and doing this sort of stuff. And gummy shark, Mako's probably number two. Gummy shark could be number one.
Okay.
Lisa, for the,
it's
for
definitely
the,
not a mile away, like it
says. He hit his head on the, he's hit his head on something there too, shark.
He has hit his head on something. Yeah. Young girls probably put a band-aid on after that photo.
How good is it the school holidays are actually leading into Easter? The break that they've had and that type of thing. They should organise that every year.
I think it's something to do with the full moon and Easter.
It's a biblical thing.
The
school holidays should rotate around.
It's not just about fishing and, you know.
Isn't Easter about fishing?
Absolutely about fishing. But you've got to go with the full moon, I think. I think there's something there.
Now, another place that has been well stocked and always is for the holidays, is Eildon Pondage.
That's right.
Jenny Barfitt got up there.
Oh, look at that.
Her first trout, a 56 centimetre, 1.9 kilo. Now, that is an ex-broodstock from the state government-owned Snobs Creek Hatchery. Okay. Yep. And it's a fantastic fish.
That's a great fish.
This is what it's all about, putting the fish in for people to catch.
There's been a lot of fish caught at the Pondage in the last week.
Yeah.
Yeah, if you have a look at some of the Facebook and Gary Constein at the shop up here, the tackle shop, some great catches.
Well, Rob Hawks is another one that got up there. Rob Hawks got a beautiful brown trout. Have a look at that.
That's another cracker. Yeah,
Look at that. Lovely colours, too.
They look great.
How big would that be?
It'd be 2.5 kilos.
Yeah, it'd have to be a couple of kilos.
Nudging 8 pounds, 10 pounds.
Yep.
Yeah.
You know, so good fish.
Yeah, nice fish. Well done, Rob.
Now.
Donnie.
I learned something about Don. No, Don's...
What,
you
he's
know,
not 84?
No, he's not 92.
92.
We're winding up for a... You know, we're almost ready to ride a lady over Queen.
For a while.
I found out that Don's only 77.
I thought he was older.
I thought he was like ready for the letter from the Queen. But Donnie, now, and Donnie takes a terrible
photo.
I
wouldn't be very happy with that.
Pretend this is a big Murray cod, right? Don normally catches a Murray cod like this, and then he holds his phone out like that and takes his own selfie, and you get half the fish and half his right elbow. You know, that's about all you get.
He was that big.
Don actually took his family away, and he's still up there at the Murray River, so he's not going to see this. So he watches a replay, and then we'll be in trouble. But Don caught an 84-centimetre Murray cod in the Murray River near...
Bigger than he is aged.
Yeah, that's his
Is it Robin Vale? Is that a 10?
Robin Vale, that's a 10.
Is that 10, Robin Vale?
Yeah.
Oh, we're not even going to show it.
Yeah.
Don't tell me.
Bad luck, Donnie.
What happened?
He's not watching. Don't worry about it.
He only mentioned it.
I think we mucked up the photo somehow.
He's not watching. Don't worry about it.
We'll work that out. After the break, we'll work out what's gone wrong with Don's photo. Because we've got to have Don's photo.
I want to see Don. I want to see how old Don looks as well, given you've said he's like nearly 100.
And it was like big smiles.
Did he just ring the report through or he actually give you a photo?
No, we've got
photos.
And hopefully we've got another fish coming up. Oh, we've got some wrong photos. They're yelling in my ear. We've got the, no, don't put that one up. That was last week. No. And
well, Dave
and the next one, have a look at this for an estuary perch. Yes. Shane Johnson caught this.
Mm-hmm.
Now, Shane Johnson, estuary perch.
Doesn't look like Shane.
Well, hang on, I've got the email here. This is an email from, we set a challenge last week, boys.
Yeah, we did.
Porsche Johnson.
Yep.
And this is the email we get off Porsche. Today we went out to try and complete the challenge that was set for me on Tuesday. My dad, Shane Johnson, caught the estuary perch and I, Porsche, in brackets, over here, caught the redfin. Both fish averaging 25 centimetres. Couldn't get anything on top water like what you guys asked, but my dad got the EP on a floating Rapala in Rainbow Trout. Porsche, not good enough. A young lady like you, if we set you a challenge, you've caught a trout. What else did she catch? She already caught a redfin.
Yeah, she already done it.
We challenged you, Porsche, to catch an estuary perch.
Deal.
Not your dad.
No deal, Porsche.
If I want Saints to win, do I rely on Collingwood?
You should always rely on Collingwood, Dave.
Sometimes.
Or Geelong.
Porsche,
the challenge is you need to catch the estuary perch. And even if you don't catch it, don't tell us your dad caught it. Just lie to us. Or
they're not that smart.
We would have believed you.
They're not that smart.
If you'd like to send in a pic of your cat, this is what you have to do.
If you want to be like me and have your photo on TV, email your fishing pic to info@ifish.com.au.
Go
find!
Yeah, I want to go fishing.
Coming up next, fisheries news, and we get into the water topics with Lisa Neville next on Talking Fishing.
Talking Fishing.
We know what you'd rather be doing.
We know what you've really got in mind.
We know you'd rather be out fishing.
And today's the day you're gonna wear the line.
'Cause every day's a good day. Stop wishing. Every day's a chance to drift away.
Drift away.
Every day's a good day for fishing.
Talking fishing, talking fishing, nothing but fishing, we're talking fishing.
Live from the studios of Channel 31 Melbourne, it's now time for some very fishy news.
I'm just going to talk with an anti-cold in my mouth. If that's all right. Yeah. I've got the worst man cold.
Yeah, if I get that man cold, you're in big strife. You know that.
Have you got it?
No, but I found an anti-cold under my chair last week. That wasn't from the last week before, was it?
Well, we're going to come back from the break. I'm keeping it in my mouth now, so I'm just bugger it. I'm not feeling well at all. Let's get into fisheries news. I think Mum Fishing is the first one. Put it up and we'll tell, I guess. There you go. I've got it right.
Yeah.
Take Mum Fishing. This is a big day for Mother's Day at Albert Park Lake, 8:30 a.m. to 1 p.m. Now, Mother's Day is the second Sunday in May.
Correct.
Am I right?
Better write that down.
Sam, if you're watching, my son, second Sunday in May.
Lobster dinner or something?
Something like that,
My wife, if you're watching, don't forget to remind me.
Remind me the day before. But at this event, 100 free rods are up for grabs for the first 100 mums to get there.
Nice.
Get to Albert Park Lake. It's a
great
free event.
Can I make a suggestion? So if you're a mum, wouldn't you want somebody to take the kids fishing so you could sleep in? Just saying.
Or go for a lobster lunch.
That's right. So you go for a long lunch while the kids are out fishing.
Not according to Travis Dowling from the Victorian Fishing.
He hasn't asked a mother. No.
I'd suggest that the kids put the worms on the hook for mum.
Yeah. No. I want the long lunch while the kids are out fishing.
Albert Park, 2nd May. Yeah. Probably going to be 13 degrees and hail.
Yeah.
Travis says, take your mum fishing.
Right. And he would know.
For a free,
being a mum.
Yeah.
Oh, no, sorry, he's not.
Yeah. Well, Travis would know all about it.
He knows what his mum wants.
Yeah. Let's go to the next one.
That went well.
Anyway, Travis will be on to Minister Neville's office tomorrow about not approving of Mother's Day. A big comp coming up this weekend, Charlie.
Correct.
Go fishing again. In fact, not this weekend. Starts Thursday, which is Anzac Day.
Yep,
a massive event. Go fishing Ngambi with my anti-coal in my mouth. $80,000 for the first Murray cod. You've been there today. What's it
like? Well, it's in the first stages of setting up, but it's a lot bigger than what I thought as far as, you know, the event, the area that's sort of where they've got the entertainment, and I'll have the main stage and then the festival area and things like that. So yeah, it's going to be really, really good. It's well set out. It's well run. The guys there and girls there are running it really good today. They're all over us for help and things like that. So, and the amount of cash they're giving away, like $80,000.
That's just for the first Murray cod.
Is that the first or the biggest?
No, the biggest. Yeah. $30,000 for the biggest yellow belly. I think it's $10,000 for the biggest carp or something.
Yeah, a dirty carp.
$400,000
for a dirty carp.
There's 3 days fishing. Yeah. There's camping, bars, bands, and big fish. Did I read the bands? Is the Rolling Stones? No?
Oh, come on now, Dave.
Maybe the Rolling
Stones. Was it Kiss?
Yeah.
Billy and the Bushwhackers? Who's Billy and the Bushwhackers?
Billy
and the Trumpets?
Well, I didn't actually recognise too many of the bands, but I might be just that era. Yeah. I do know the Rolling Stones.
Wouldn't be so, Skyhooks.
Yeah.
But they're one band that can't reform, aren't they, Skyhooks? Red Simons wouldn't do it and Shirley can't.
Yeah, that's right.
But I love the Skyhooks.
I was a Sherbet fan. So
well, you see, Daryl Braithwaite's still doing that.
He's around. He's Survivor. Yeah.
Skyhooks. Can they find someone?
Yeah.
I love Skyhooks.
But it wouldn't be the same. You can't replace a front man. Especially like Shirley.
Queens coming out for tour. Yeah. ABBA's coming out on a screen.
Hologram.
Anyway, the $80,000
is a pretty
good deal.
We had people in from Western Australia, driven over from Western Australia, come into the shop today and said, "We've come here for the go fishing again. We're getting here early. We're going to go fish it."
Really?
And things like that. So we had two people from Western Australia come in.
So they're coming from all over the place.
Yeah, it's fantastic.
It's big. Mm-hmm. Looking forward to next week for if you can give us a good report on how it all went.
I'm looking forward to next week too when it's all over.
Are you aiming to try and get the 80 grand?
We will be having a fish as staff. Yeah, we've put in our names and bits and pieces. So everyone's.
Half our staff are because I've got to work Anzac Day, got to work Sunday. All my staff are gone to the game. I've got to work, slave away. Anyway, let's keep going. Vic Fish Kids is coming up. There's some good things coming up. Very shortly, there's a whole program, all this is upside down. But there's five events program, there you go. Sunday, 5th of May, which is coming up, Williamstown Pier, 15th of September. All the dates and venues are on your screen there. If you go to the next slide, boys, the big one is with Bashahooli. On Sunday, the 5th of May, 10 a.m. till 4 p.m. Bashahooli will be there. He is. Let's just do the front bar and the footy show. Bashahooli is an out for Sunday the 5th of May.
Yep.
And someone else from the reserves will be coming in because Bashahooli is going fishing for the day. He won't be playing for Richmond. Mm-hmm. And don't put your money on Richmond. So
he did something in Bellarine recently. Mm. He's a great spokesperson.
He loves fishing.
Absolutely loves it. There you go. Now, Lisa, let's start talking to you.
Yep.
I reckon where it all started. Well, no, it probably all started with Tolondo. You saved Tolondo.
Tolondo, yes.
As the Minister for Water. Yeah. But what you did also was create, I would have to say, one of the best stocked bass fisheries in Victoria. Let's wind back the clock and have a look at what you did.
Because you know I'm all about that bass, no trouble. 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 I'm all about that bass.
I'm here with the Minister for Water and Environment, Lisa Neville. We're putting 12 of these beautiful bass into Blue Rock. If you catch one of these tagged fish, plenty of prizes coming your way. Total value, $2,000.
I'm all about that bass, no trouble. I'm all about that bass, no trouble. I'm all about that bass.
Well, normally you would crack a nice champagne when you go to an occasion like this. The new restrictions are in place at Blue Rock Lake. No champagne. A nice cup of tea with the Minister, Lisa Neville. It's a great day for fishing, and what today does is opens up a great bass fishery, great trout fishery in Blue Rock to many people that have been restricted off the lake.
Lisa, what's some of the restriction changes? So bigger boats, bigger motors now?
So it used to be that you couldn't have a certain length of boat, you couldn't have horsepower, so we've removed both of those restrictions. So that means that we can have the boats that people now use actually use in the lake. I think it was a very outdated regulation that was put in place to protect something we no longer need to protect from, that's erosion. So this is a common sense approach. It's about providing opportunities for our wreck fishing community to now use this great facility here.
As the Minister said, it's a great thing for fishing, it's a great facility. We're going to head out the boat and have a look at how great it is.
Yeah.
One of the things you didn't show, though, just remembering that day, was we put the bass in the water, and we did get a bit of feedback from people
we sort of threw them.
We were very excited, and apparently that's not great for native fish.
That bit out.
Oh, no. Well, anyway, it just sticks in my mind, but it does.
You do realise that you on that day, you don't. I mean, they're just little subtle changes that you think you make, and I don't know that the feedback gets back to you enough that you created probably the number one bass fishery that features on the show now.
Yeah, definitely.
And from an access point of view, people love it. What it's done for the local economy, you know, you can't describe how good that is. Yeah. But
I've learned along the way about the importance of being able to provide those opportunities, recreational water, fishing access, all of that. It really makes a difference to people, to people's enjoyment, to their lives, and their health and well-being.
So the next thing you're doing, there's quite a number of waterways that are being opened up to kayaks and small watercraft.
Yep.
Barks Creek, already opened.
Already
we featured
opened.
That the
With
other week.
Golden
the local
perch in it already. Yeah. I think some Murray cod coming soon.
I heard a rumour today that there's some decent Murray cod.
I think there's some pretty decent Murray cod going
into Barker's Creek.
Because we saw a good ready taken not too long after that.
A massive ready.
I'm
talking 2 to 3 kilo Murray cod.
At least 2 kilos.
That's not. I might have to win the ring
file. I've heard the same rumour, David.
Tullaroo, but you've got a whole of others.
So 1st of May. Tullaroop, late May, should be open, and the rest should be by the 1st of August. So we've got
Upper Coloman,
Malmesbury, Lauriston, Hepburn, open for canoes, kayaks, and the small craft.
By?
1st of August.
1st of August.
Yeah, yep.
That is unbelievable.
So people might say, why wait? Why not do them now? Yep. But we're under the legislation around safe water, drinking water. We have to just do a risk assessment.
Yep.
We're pretty confident we're going to be able to manage any risk to the drinking water.
Yeah.
So 1st of August.
There you go.
Yeah. And look, one of the things I love the most is Green Lake. I'm not sure if people have had a chance to go to Green Lake, but filling that lake, getting water back in that lake, and now we've got golden perch in there as well.
Yeah.
So go up and see Green Lake. It is a spectacular lake.
Yep.
To see people when I turned the water on for that lake, and Tolondo was the same.
We saw Tolondo in
as well.
Tears in their eyes.
It is. It's got often a historical, you know, families have grown up with it, and to be able to see it returned has been fantastic.
Yeah. And I got here 1st of August 2020.
Yep.
You're going to have boat ramps and car parks.
So Travis has promised that. So this is Travis. I'm looking at Travis. Ooh, Travis, if you're watching, which I'm sure he is, to see if we say anything good or bad about him.
Yeah.
Yes, he's said that's right, boat ramps and car parks to just increase access.
Small boats with electric motors.
That's right.
Which is no problem to the environment. So 1st of August 2020 is
that's right.
How good is that?
Yeah, yeah.
Got to keep moving. Product of the week next. And we're going to talk some more water with Lisa Neville shortly on Talking Fishing.
Talking Fishing.
Good morning, spotters. Stephanie speaking.
Talking fishing, nothing but fishing, we're talking fishing.
Dave was going to introduce me as we see him on the camera, but he's choking on an anti-coal, so I think I'll jump straight in here. There is a little bit going on at the moment, as we've touched on quite a bit in the last couple of shows, with a lot of new waterways being opened up to kayaks and small boats. So we want to show you a little bit of gear that is very storage efficient, but very handy. And then we're talking about nets. We haven't seen nets for a long, long time that are kayak or small boat friendly, because they're big, cumbersome things with long handles, trying to sort that out.
And we're never really interested until you come along.
That's right. So you know what? This is my segment, and I'm going to dominate it with kayak stuff.
That's it.
Frable have been in the market for a long time, and they specify in this exact sort of thing. So this that I'm holding right now is your standard little net, so perfect for yellow belly and brim, estuary perch, bass that we spoke about in Blue Rock. But the good thing about it is, in its shortest form, it actually folds in half.
Oh wow,
that's great.
That so now that becomes all you need to store. But trying to deal with 6 foot and a, 6.5 foot rods and longer, you still need a little bit of length to get to get the fish without damaging graphite rods.
Got something better?
Yeah, I have got something better. Yeah. That's the little one. Check out this bad boy. Now, believe it or not, what I'm holding here is a net.
No way.
Yep, it is a net.
Wow.
Check that out.
That's fantastic.
What?
That is really cool. Clever, so now, that is the
Who
smaller one.
Who came up
one.
With that idea?
I don't know, but they've done a bloody good job.
Bill.
Because
Bill.
Mr. Frable sorted that out.
Bill Frable.
That's the smallest one. So it comes in small, big and ridiculous.
Yep.
The big one is an absolute weapon, but this thing is so cool. You literally slide the net head back into the handle, and now you can store that in a gunwale of a small boat.
Or in a tinny, like just in a rod hole, horizontal rod hole or something like that.
It can sit there, and then when you need it, it's as simple as this.
That's right.
That's the small one.
And that's
See,
the small
I think
one.
I could
that
even
size,
use that.
That's cool.
You can catch
it.
Ah, oh.
Jeez. It's a bit heavier than the fish I'm used to catching. But that, that's the Frable net. Please get into your local tackle store and check them out, because for the storage conscious with small craft, and they are becoming more and more popular, more popular than your big boats, Dave.
Yeah,
we're having waterways
right.
open specifically for us. Yeah. These are really, really cool. Yep, so check them out.
Way to go. And those 2 to 3 kilo Murray cod that are going to go into
perfect.
Perfect on your kayak.
Yep.
Because you're going to need a net to land them.
Yes, okay. you are.
Go. All right, let's move along. We talked about 92-year-old Don Newman, who's we've now realised he's 77.
Yeah.
Lisa, you'd like to meet Don. I think we've now
had
Don's photo. Have a look at... There you go.
Yeah, so I feel really bad that Don's been considered 92. He doesn't look
Donnie,
92.
Do you reckon he looks 77?
He looks... Oh, no, actually, more in the 60s, I reckon.
You don't look a day over 35, don't
you? Oh, you might be in 60s,
actually,
but I don't
really
know.
Don, if you've got extra fish hanging around,
send them our way.
Conditions look a bit average.
Yeah, fish looks good.
Now, Don's only one of many, many Murray cods into us too. So, well done. There you go, Don. We
good on you, Donnie.
That took a while.
That could take a while. All right, let's get into the nitty gritty, Lisa. Every net, I reckon once a year, it makes the headlines that you place an order. I don't know the technicalities of it, but you place an order with the desalination plant.
Yep.
Right? And now, correct me if I'm wrong, but is desalination plant fires up because... from a human consumption point of view, we need water.
Is that largely,
the,
largely.
That's the main
reason
you're
firing
it up.
It's largely for drinking water. Yeah. So,
excuse my ignorance, but it's actually in operation. I had no idea it was even being used.
Yeah, so we've used it now since 2016 was the first order.
Mm-hmm.
We then had some minimum orders of 15 gigs. For this 12-month period, we'll do 125 gigs. That's because everyone knows you go outside, it's dry.
It's dry.
Yep. Yep. Yeah.
Hottest and driest summer on record. And I think this start to the year is the driest ever on record as well. So so we've placed that order, and it's largely for human consumption, potable water, drinking water. But it, you know, does it have broader benefits?
Well, is it there to provide or could it be there to provide recreational water?
Well, it's not cheap water. So what I see it as is substitution. So if I think about, for example, you know, I know later you want to talk about the Gippsland Lakes. There's, if you think back, you know, we have an entitlement to water in the Thompson River that goes to the Gippsland Lakes, through the Gippsland Lakes.
That's if we don't environmental flow.
That's right, that's right. So if we don't have enough water for Melburnians to drink, live on, we would take that off. And that's what happened in the Millennium Drought. So the Yarra River Environment Entitlement, we had to qualify that right and take it back because we had so little water. So I see it as a substitution. So it means that we have less call on those other environmental entitlements if we've got this access to this water in DCL.
So who makes the decision then, and ultimately you might say the voters do, who makes the decision to go, we need some water for fishing, for water skiing, a bit more for the environment, and can we have it from the desal plant? How would that process work? Or is there no process
in
place?
Look, there really isn't. So the key focus is the basic decision is based on the what do we need to do to keep Melbourne water supply. So just think it's Melbourne water customers who are paying for the desal plant. How do we keep us with a safe buffer zone so that we don't drop to dangerous levels, which happened in 2009, 2008. We dropped significantly down to 40%. That really puts in doubt our ability to just give drinking water to people.
Yeah.
So this is about stopping that, but also then enabling people, you know, to still deliver the environmental flows to the Yarra, to the Thompson, and therefore Gippsland Lakes.
When you make desal plant, desal water, where does it go?
So the desal water goes into, well, it can directly go to South Gippsland, parts of South Gippsland, Baggy.
But does it end up in one lake and then you draw it from the lake? Well,
Goes into the Cadinia Reservoir. So
which
it's sort of
that's not a massive lake.
No, but it's mixed with our, you know, so it's shandied, as they say.
Yeah.
It can go to Sylvan Reservoir, but it can be delivered directly into Southeast Water customers as well.
Rather than go via the lake.
If you needed to. Yeah, so if you had a contamination, for example, you could do it that way, and you can deliver straight to South
Gippsland. So from Cadinia, can it then pump, like, can it pump to the Thompson?
No, we don't do it that way. It goes to Sylvan.
It's
so our system is sort of Thompson through, you know, we've got a very connected water system, unlike most others. So Melbourne is a very connected system.
Yep.
So what happens here affects what happens there.
Mm.
But no, we don't put it into the Thompson. But what it means is we don't have to draw on the Thompson as much.
Mm.
So it keeps the Thompson at a safe level. Mm. That's our biggest water supply in Melbourne. Hasn't been full since 1996.
Mm.
So it's 80% is the maximum.
I tell you what it's full of, the Thompson.
Yeah.
Beautiful trout.
Yeah, but it is a protected water system. But,
but the other thing I'd say is that Premier did say that he might look at opening up the Thompson.
So I'll come back to that in a moment. But the other thing about diesel is the other thing is that if you look across what we've done across the state, the Wimmera Mallee pipeline, if we hadn't built that, there'd be no water in any lakes. So that's been able to secure both water supply for townships but also recreational entitlements. Similar to the Goldfield Superpipe, like you wouldn't have in places like Epilock, you wouldn't have any water because there wouldn't be enough to drink, let alone for recreational lakes. So you have a look, the system is not just diesel, it's a whole grid system.
Now they're just yelling in my ear that I got that wrong. It wasn't the Thompson that the Premier
said,
Thompson's off the board. Very quickly, there's a pipeline. I think it was called the North-South pipeline. Could it become the South-North pipeline with pumps on the other end to help people up in Trelly's area?
Well, firstly, I'd say we're not taking any water from Shepparton. I think when it was first built, there was a tension to move water from the north to Melbourne. And that was when Melbourne's water supply was at really critical levels. You're never doing that.
Yeah. They did pump it over one stage.
Only for firefighting.
Yep.
So it works and it's used for firefighting.
Yeah,
okay. But to pump it the other way, so you technically yes, but it's a cost. It's not just the pumps, it's also the infrastructure because
Not a simple job.
No, it's $300 million. So that water would cost a lot of money.
Yeah. So I'm just going to put a line through that idea of yours.
That's not to say you'd never do it. It depends on what happens in the future.
Yeah.
But it is a very expensive water, and you might in the future say it's worth subsidies and worth paying
for
that.
How much a meg would you think of?
Oh, I can't remember, but we're talking maybe
$1,000 a meg.
Yeah. Trailer the yelling ass, we're going to go
for a break. For an irrigator, you'd never do it,
for
example. Yeah.
You reckon we've touched on the tough subjects? Yeah. Not yet. We're talking with Lisa Neville, the Minister for Water, but coming up next, Kramer's Mailbag, and then we're going to touch the tough subjects next on Talking Fishing.
Talking Fishing.
We know what you'd rather be doing.
We know what you've really got in mind.
We know you'd rather be out fishing.
And today's the day you're gonna wet a line.
'Cause every day's a good day. Stop wishing.
Every day's a chance to drift away.
Drift away.
Every day's a good day for fishing.
See you down at Tackle World today.
Talking fishing, talking fishing. Nothing but fishing, we're talking fishing.
Welcome back to Talking Fishing. We do have the Minister for Water, Lisa Neville, in the house with us tonight, talking about the tough issues on water. But before that, a couple of things to talk about, boys. This is a good bit of mail that opened for a bit of discussion here. It says, "G'day, David. As the end of the trout season approaches in the coming month or so, well, it's June, it ends, my mind is cast back to the stonkers that were caught in the Goulburn River last trout opening weekend following the release of an unbelievable number of these incredible brood fish from the hatchery in the lead up to the weekend. It was the biggest fishing frenzy I think I have ever seen." This is from James. "With so many rainbow trout averaging 4 to 5 kilos, it was great to see big smiles on many anglers' faces. Will this be happening again this year? If so, do you think it would be better if the VFA released the fish across the opening month to spread out the fishing opportunity and attract anglers to the region over successive weekends? Also, would a reduced bag limit of one fish over 50 centimetres on this section of the Goulburn in the opening month promote more catch and release and mean that more of these big fish would survive to be caught again throughout the season? Also, with brown trout having a larger lifespan, would it make sense to release big brown trout into the river, particularly over winter, to allow them to settle into a more wild feeding behaviour? Can you please check with the VFA and report back to us about the stonkers?"
Stonkers. Still catching them. Yeah,
the word is the stonkers will be released again. They're still catching
really?
Them.
Yep.
Seven and a half tonne, I think it was.
And I think that's important. I don't think we really need to spread them out over a certain amount of days because A, it gives you the wow factor of the trout opening, and B, the fish are still being caught.
Yeah.
So a lot of people are participating in catch and release.
I've heard a lot of the caravan parks and motels are already booked out.
It's an amazing thing. It's one of the best things I've ever done for trout opening because the buzz now is back for trout opening.
I hate to say it, I think this was Travis Dowling's idea. He just comes up with all the good ideas, doesn't he?
That was a cross. Because that worked an absolute treat and they are still catching those big brood rainbows now.
Yeah. Brown trout's an interesting thing.
That's an interesting one.
Don't know their availability of big stonkers, but certainly the rainbows.
So I think most people put back after they catch one, or you also want to catch a trophy and put it back. Those people don't put them back.
Yeah, exactly.
That's an interesting one you've got there, Dave.
I can't read. I can't read all this.
Not from Don Newman, is it?
No. Some of the same vintage, though. Hi, David. This is from Alan. And he writes, "Hi David, thank you for highlighting so many matters of concern to fishermen and dealing with them in a positive way. With this in mind, please find enclosed an article," and it was enclosed, "about gummy shark numbers in Port Phillip Bay. Regardless of any personal interest, the fishery, I am convinced for some time now that more needs to be done to preserve pregnant female gummy sharks, especially in view of their slow reproduction rate." I agree with that. At the moment, return of such sharks to the water unharmed is a voluntary matter for fishermen. From my experience, voluntary is not adequate, and real change would only come with proper regulation and penalties for non-compliance. Now, it could go on, but it says pretty much...
That's the drift. The big gummy shark debate.
Should there be a slot limit on gummy sharks? And he's also sort of saying that gummy sharks are on the decline. Well, I don't agree with that. Gummy sharks, I think we've just, you know, I mean, we, Adam, we get a lot of photos sent to us. You do too, Elliot, correct. Down, particularly at Geelong.
That's for sure.
I would have to say it's been one of the best years on gummy sharks.
Well, I think it's a tough one,
but I think
more than confident to back the scientific research that the VFA put into this. Now, they claim it's a sustainable fishery.
Mm.
I support them 100% because there's no reason to believe that they are in decline or that what they're saying is rubbish.
Mm.
What I do agree with is maybe more education on these big pregnant females, because I think that is something from a moral standpoint that's worth looking at. Maybe something, we've just seen Care for Cod, that program.
Yep.
We could, a similar thing could be broadcast for dummy sharks on how,
this is
the education trolley. Maybe on how to identify that,
which would be a size. I think if they're a certain size, they're probably pregnant.
Or how to care for those fish if you have got one.
Yeah.
But just you know what I mean, a bit more education. Yeah. I don't think anything needs to be done as far as.
No, I'm 100% with you. Anyway, we've got to wind this up because we've got some real issues to talk about. If you'd like to write into Kramer's Mailbag, this is what you do.
Send your mail to Kramer's Mailbag, PO Box 734, Paterson Lakes, Victoria 3197, or email kramer@ifish.com.au.
Now, we're joined by Lisa Neville, Minister for Water. Now, Minister, in the Stock and Land Melbourne, which I guess is a magazine or a newspaper or whatever, there was an article during the week, record volumes of water are being traded from the Goulburn Valley to the Murray system. And it's, I think it's called inter-valley transfer. And we've had discussions where people talk to us about the volume of water going down the Goulburn River.
Yeah.
And Trelly, you've seen a few things.
Like, yeah, well, we see this out of season flow, which is a consistent flow. Now, I believe that they can't go above a certain flow rate. So it gets to this certain flow and it stays there. And this year it stayed, last year I think it stayed for like 3 months, and this year it stayed about the same.
Mm.
And it's cutting into that bank area about sort of like a metre above the bank, roughly. I've been down there, and you sort of go and have a look and have a look at that, what I call the riparian zone. And it's just depleted of actual plant life. So what we do with the environmental water, what we do with the environmental, it actually promotes a bit of growth. But this last 2 years has just turned that upside down. And just
what's been a record this year. And the other thing that I'm told it does is that because you're putting that volume of, and it's colder water, it's not natural for the native fish, and so the native fish won't breed.
That's right, yeah. So it does turn the table up on the native fish breeding.
I've got a question. Why is there that need for inter-valley transfer? There's obviously a lot of water going from the Goulburn or from Eildon to the Murray system, isn't it?
So firstly, you know, we're similarly concerned. So we are monitoring this issue. And in fact, at the last Murray-Darling Basin Ministers meeting, we put on the table the issue of deliverability. Mm. So how much water can you deliver down the system without actually causing environmental harm, given the Murray-Darling Basin plan is all about improving environmental outcomes.
Yeah.
But in this case, what we've seen is a probably quite unusual event this year and a bit last year, where you've got New South Wales in very, very dry conditions.
Mm.
But to the point, normally when New South Wales is dry like this, you've got water coming on the market for Victoria. But in this case, we've had a lot of particular cotton farmers who have kept up international contracts. Mm. So they've been, because they're worth so much, they've been buying so much water. Secondly, the demand, because we've also been a bit dry and people are thinking about what's ahead, they've also been in the Sunraysia area purchasing water. So there's large volumes of water moving down the system to entitlement holders, basically, to farmers, to agriculture. What we're currently looking at is, do we need to set a trade cap at all or some other mechanism to look at this issue to set a limit to a threshold? We haven't got the answer yet. We're looking at that now. Fish stocks are still doing well in the Goulburn, but we are concerned not just about fish stocks but the overall environmental health along the Goulburn. I'm hoping we can say something a bit later this year. But because
Lisa, when you say fish stocks are in good nick, Is there enough science going on to say that we haven't missed 2 years of breeding now?
It's still pretty good. The CMA do quite a lot of, because it's part of both our Murray-Darling Basin obligations, but also just our own investment in waterway health that we are looking at it. But there's no doubt that what we know that overbank flows can cause environmental damage. So So at the moment, we're trying to deliver for farmers. None of this is environmental water at the moment. Yep. This is all largely bought water that is sustaining our agriculture industry in very difficult times. So do we need to change the administrative arrangements? Do we need to set a threshold so that you're a bit, you know, what's the safe level to give agriculture what they need, but also protect the environment?
We just feel in our area that there's too much water being sold downstream, and that water has a delivery problem. That water's got to be delivered in one form or another. Yep. The Goulburn's being used as a channel.
Yeah.
It's got a constant high flow, which is causing bank cutting. It's causing erosion of tree roots and things like that.
So, look, you know, we have a water market, which I think ultimately works in everyone's favour. Mm. And in most cases, the Goulburn area benefits the most. Most of the water is traded into the Goulburn. Mm. But there are times when it's traded out. Mm. There is the Barmah choke, which is a natural constraint, and we need to take account of that. So there are rules in place about how much water can head to the Sunraysia area at any given time. Mm. How much can we deliver? Mm. I don't think we've been sophisticated enough yet to understand how much can you deliver. And this is critical both for our trade system, but for the Murray-Darling Basin as well. Like, can we actually deliver the water to South Australia, for example, without doing significant environmental damage to Victorian waterways? Yeah.
Well,
that's the question now.
Yeah.
That's right. And that's exactly what we're looking at now.
That's right.
Oh, guys, got to go to a break. We might continue on this or go to the next one. Not sure. We'll talk about it during the break. Next, the all-important hotspots for this weekend. Next on Talking Fishing.
Talking Fishing.
G'day, Callan here from Paul Worsland's Tackle World Cranbourne.
Supercharged batteries have been supplying maintenance-free marine batteries since 2001. The Seamaster Gold Range is second to none, delivering superior starting power and reserve capacity. No need to top up with water, truly a fit-and-forget battery. With up to 2 years replacement warranty, you know you have quality. Your battery is your lifeline. Without it, you're dead in the water because it's bloody hard to push start.
I've got a Seamaster battery in my boat.
Make yours a Seamaster Gold today.
Talking fishing, nothing but fishing, we're talking fishing.
And now the segment you've all been waiting for.
Hotspots, brought to you by Seamaster Batteries.
All right, let's get through the hotspots really quickly. Let's head to Port Phillip straight away, and I'm told that there's very good King George Whiting boys sitting in the Simmons Channel.
The Simmons?
Accessible easily from... Cryo Bay or St. Leonard's boat ramp, places like that. So some beautiful King George Whiting. If you want to head to the other side of the bay for you kayakers, Adam, and even land-based if you want, around Beau Morris, there's some lovely pinky snapper.
There is heaps, and there's also that kicker of that 2.5-3 kilo fish. I've seen a lot of fish, especially on soft plastics.
Yep.
Make the most of it.
This time of year, they're getting particularly. I think we've got a very big southwesterly blow on Friday and Saturday.
The land-based guys are going to love it.
It's going to be so good for snapper. Let's head over to Western Port now on the western entrance. If anyone doesn't follow Sean Ferdier from Think Big Fishing Charters in Western Port, then do yourself a favour, go and have a look, because the gummy shark fishery in Western Port, particularly where Sean fishes, and he never tells you, the western entrance, is absolutely fantastic. So I'm sure we've put that one up. I might have missed that one. Middle Spit Whiting. That's why they didn't put it up. Middle Spit Whiting. Then let's go to the western entrance for gummy sharks.
There it is.
All right, we've caught up. Middle Spit's fantastic too, by the way. Let's head to the west of the state.
Correct.
My bearings for a second there. Some magnificent barrels still being caught. Barrel tuna, 100 kilo.
Still busy.
Off Portland and Port Max. So they're still coming through the system.
Still in close, and there is a lot of school fish out beyond the shelf too.
And lucky last, get to Lake Eildon this weekend, because every cod fisherman's at Ngambie.
Yeah. That's right.
The
place to
yourself. Go to Lake Eildon.
There's also the Clifton Springs jetty, just saying.
Yeah.
Calamari.
Took you
during the break, I did ask the question, is there another way of transporting that water from Eildon into the Murray? No.
No, there's no other way. So it's about how we use trade rules.
Yep.
Do we put in place a threshold? And that's exactly what we're
looking
at.
Do you guys consider the level of Eildon? Because I think Eildon's dropped from, I saw Jane Bunn talking about it. Yeah. I think it went from 60 to 40% or something like that.
Yeah.
Is that a danger limit to getting Eildon too low?
Well, except that there is entitlement holders in terms of Eildon, same with Epilock. So people that own water have that right are entitled to it. So
All right. There is some proposed legislation. I'd love to know what stage it's up to regarding recreational water from a management point of view. Tell us about that.
Yeah, so we've got legislation right now in the Parliament. For the first time, we're amending the Water Act to provide for the environmental water holder, our CMAs, our water authorities, to have to take account of recreational needs when they're making decisions. So what might that mean? So if a CMA is deciding when and when not to water, they need to consult with recreational users so that if we've got an ability to share the benefits of the water, let's do that. Yep. So if we water now because it's going to get a good outcome for fishing or whatever it is, you know, let's do that if we can.
So how do you do that?
Piggyback a flow.
Basically, piggyback a flow. That's right. Or change the timing of the flow because it gets better.
To help
it still has a positive environmental outcome but has a recreational outcome as well.
So how do you talk to the recreationals on that? Do you put a recreational person on every water board or?
Well, there is a process. There is a consultative process that should have recreational people involved in that. So from duck shooters through to fishing people. That's right.
Water skiers.
So it's about encouraging both that dialogue and an opportunity to look at not just have a one lens when you look at water and try and get a whole range of benefits out of that water.
Interesting.
And so it legislation is for the first time. So of course at the end of the day, you know, we all need water to survive, so that's the number one priority. But where you can get the broader outcomes, let's do that.
Yeah, beautiful. Yeah. Lisa, thanks for coming in.
We need a 2-hour show, Dave.
Two-hour special. Sincerely,
great to be here.
Coming in, and water's a tough thing. Whenever you're in drought, the pressure's
on,
isn't it?
That's right.
That is a big thing, but thank you very much.
Great
and
to be here.
We'll have you back next season, but that's it for Talking Fishing. We hope you enjoyed the show. Next week, it's the last show for the season, would you believe, before we take our winter break, and we hope to have a very special guest. Now, that could be Bill Shorten. ScoMo, John Farnham, Daryl Braithwaite. What's the bloke off Mick Malloy? Could be Chloe Malloy. I don't know.
Could be Lisa.
It's going to be. Not going to tell you yet. But it'll be a cracking show. It'll either be a massive flop or a great show. Either way, we're going to end the season with a bang. Until we see you again next Tuesday on Talking Fishing, please stay safe on the water and enjoy your fishing.
Talking fishing, nothing but fishing, we're talking fishing. We got all you need, just take a look. Watch those fish jump on your hook. So just relax and take your time. Enjoy the show, then drop us a line. Talking fishing, nothing but fishing, we're talking fishing. Talking fishing, nothing but fishing, we're talking fishing.